Hi, everyone. How are y'all doing today? That is louder than I expected it was going to be. So first of all, I'm thrilled to be here. This is awesome. And today I'm going to be going over the main title sequence for Mike Judge's new show, Tales from the Tour Bus. We're going to go over some like skill level that's probably on the lower side. We're not getting too complex. Basically going over my thought process for how I approached animating this spot. A little bit about me is this? I have been using Cinema 4D for 16 years. I was freelancing in Los Angeles for a bunch of shops for 10 years. Then I moved to Austin, and where I was creative director at a small shop called Thousand Ships. I mostly work in Cinema 4D and After Effects. I'm a motion graphic artist slash compositor. Currently, I am working at Rooster Teeth in Austin as a compositor. My supervising lead is sitting right in the audience here, so I have to do a really good job. Stare at him, make him feel awkward. It'll make me feel less awkward. I'm going to play a little bit of my reel, not the entire thing, because it's a bit on the long side, so you can kind of see where I'm coming from. All right, I hope you enjoy.
Trying to tell you, y'all Emma can kill this rebel. She said, I bow you over. He said, it's cool, now girl, roll over. Take it like a man, stand like a soldier. Boys make noise, I'm taking over.
I know you want it.
That'll do, pig. So that's a little bit of my work. And more than a little bit of that is work that I've done for a company in Los Angeles called Shine Studio. They're a cool little shop that does a lot of main titles. And so with them, I've animated the main titles for Kung Fu Pandas 1 and 2, Temple Grandin for HBO, Too Big to Fail, a bunch of other TV shows and movies, Pitch Perfect. Really fun stuff. And so this summer, I got the opportunity to work on this project. This is a Cinemax show that Mike Judge put out this summer. It is a show that is animated like other Mike Judge shows, but telling real stories, sort of like cartoons to go along with the stories of crazy adventures that different, like, you know, musicians had on the road on their tour buses in like the 60s and 70s and 80s. Recommend it. It's a cool show. So where I started was I received boards from Shine, and I'm going to show them to you now to kind of get an idea of what this spot looked like before I show it to you. So the boards are pretty simple, like most boards you get from an agency or from a production company. And it's an old bus driving through the desert at night. It goes by, you see the characters from the show, the episode that we're about to see. And then this lanyard, like a backstage pass kind of thing, comes into view, shows the name of the show, spins around, and shows us who's going to be the subject of the first episode. Lost a frame. Comes right at the frame. Now I'm going to play for you the actual piece. Okay, you can see it's pretty much the boards. Let's see. We have two main sections. We have the bus section and the lanyard section. And we had certain challenges going in. They wanted this to be short, to get right to the show. They wanted it to be very readable, so that when we are watching this, that we have time to read all the characters' names and see them, and we don't want it to judder and jitter too much as it goes by. And lastly, they wanted all of these cards to be replaceable by the production company without any plugins or without anything. So I had to build this kind of simply and then deliver it as an After Effects project without anything in it that they could just swap out whatever they needed. So today what we're going to do is we're going to go over three main sections. When I'm working on a project and I look at the boards, I think about what are going to be my biggest challenges, because I want to tackle those first to get those out of the way so I can really focus on the creative parts that are going to be really focused on by the client. So we're going to do a little bit of modeling, starting with the bus, just some very basic starting modeling to kind of get the idea across, because like the shape of the bus was kind of a big deal to like nail down, and then working on the details would just be building out details later. The lanyard seemed simple enough to model, but the animation needed to be, somewhat realistic, but also simple enough that when it came in, you weren't distracted by it, you know, moving around too much. So the first thought I had with this section was dynamics, but I decided that dynamics would probably be a little too difficult to control. So that is basic PSR, position, scale, rotation, animation, and deformers. And then the last section we're going to cover is how I brought it all together in After Effects with Cineware. Cineware is a plugin in After Effects that allows you to bring in Cinema 4D projects and treat them as footage. So I was doing editorial on this. Granted, it's two shots, so editorial is a strong word, but it was important to get the timing right, so I did that without rendering a single frame out of Cinema 4D. This is the frame that explains that, and we don't need it anymore. Great. So let's just dig right into Cinema 4D and start with the bus. This is my final Cinema 4D file. You can kind of see where we are going with this. Let me find the camera. There we go. So this is what we're going to need to be doing, so we can kind of get an idea of how much of the bus we're going to see, how much we need to model. So for the most part, just getting that shape. That's what we're going to focus on right now. So the first thing I'm going to do is find my start here. I am just starting with a simple primitive, a primitive cube. And I already did the busy work of finding out the dimensions of buses, which was harder to find than I expected. But we're going to take this cube, and right now, this is not set up correctly. Let's do that to there so we can see the edges. This is, being a simple cube, it just has one poly on each side, so six polys all together. I am going to look at these boards to kind of figure out the rough shape of my bus. So for the most part, the bottom looks pretty simple. It's just a rectangular solid that has a little bit of curved edges. But then there's a point where it kind of tilts a little bit back where the windows start. And then it tilts a lot more back at the very top for aerodynamics, I imagine, because cubes are not very aerodynamic. So thinking about that, I'm going to think that I need 1, 2, 3 poly segments in the Y direction. So I'm going to go in and just rough out those three segments. Then I know that down the road, I'm probably going to need a little more depth to it. So nope, not that one. I'm just going to add a few just to have those there later on, even though we won't get to those in this presentation. Next, I'm going to take this cube, and I'm going to make it editable. So now it is no longer a live shape that I can change those segments, but it is like polygonal geometry. From there, I am going to use the subdivision surface to drag that in. I'm going to create it. Comes in up here. drop in. Oh, one thing I like to do is I'll drop it into my object just because I don't believe my object is at 000. It's at 1600. Okay. And I'm going to throw that back out here, drop the cube inside, and you can see that it really smooths everything out. What it does is it ups the numbers of polygons, and you can see that here. What the viewer sees is two polys for every one poly that we have. So if I turn this off, you can see it changes. Subdivision renderer is a higher value. So what we're going to do is we're going to go up to the subdivision renderer amount, 3, becomes a lot more detailed. Now, I need to make one slight adjustment that I forgot to do beforehand. Navigation, turn off. We all work a little differently, and I like that Cinema lets us change that for how we work. All right, so with the subdivision surface selected, all I see are my subdivision surface or my SDS options. So clicking on cube, and then down here to the polygon selection, I can select the original polygons that are, here, if I turn that off, you can see how it correlates, but it is smoothing it automatically. And what I'm going to do is using the edges, the edge tool, I'm going to select all the edges. And if I hold down the period key and I drag my mouse, it'll shows me how much I can smooth this object. And generally, the most smooth makes a, like if you had a pure cube, a six-sided cube, it would turn it into a sphere. So I am going to find kind of a general, all right, I'm going to completely hard-edged. Actually, let's bring it back just a hair. There we go. That looks nice and smooth, kind of similar to my bus. Next thing I'm going to do is I am going to just sort of rough out the general shape of where I want these edges to be relative to where I want them to be to represent the bus. So using my shortcut UL, I can do a loop selection, and I can select all of the edges around there, switch to my movement, my transform, and let's move that up a little higher to around roughly where I think it's going to be. Same thing here with this one. I'm going to loop select and then transform, move those up just a hair. I think that seems about right. That's about 40% of the shape. That's about 50% of the shape. That's about 10% of the shape. That feels close enough. I can always change it later. This one is tilted back just a hair, so I'm going to move that back just a little bit. It means I got to move that one back a little bit more. Yeah, give it a nice edge. I can select individual edges here and sharpen them up just a little bit. And so that's, you know, that's getting in the ballpark of what I want. The bottom is not correct because this is pretty much pressed sheet metal or fabricated, so it's a hard edge at the bottom. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to loop select around the bottom of the shape, like that, and then holding that period key, boom, I'm going to make it a hard edge down there, but it's still rounded because of how I've treated this edge. So that's pretty bus-shaped. That's bus-ish. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make some front windshields. So I created a new cube. That's a primitive, just like I created the bus. And this cube, because we are not in the center space of the world, you can see that it's, well, really far out there, back there. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to drop that. Well, first of all, no, I'll do this right now. Drop that into my cube. Zero it out. It is being affected by the subdivision surface, so I'm going to drag it outside of that. Okay, I've got a cube. That looks great. It's not the right size. It's a little big. So I am just going to really quickly rough out a shape. And this will make sense down the road. I think I just made a pun. Here we go. Let's kind of, we're just kind of putting this roughly where I want one of the windows. That looks good. It's a little hard-edged. Let's go into that object and give it a little bit of a fillet. That is too much. It's made it way too round. That's, I don't know, 10? Let's see. Let's look at our bus. I would say probably about 5. That looks good. Next thing we're going to do is we are going to make a symmetry object. Drop that into our bus. Oh, I guess I could put it right here, and that is also 0. Good. Oh, no, I put that right in the wrong place. Cool. So now this is much more localized to our bus. I'm going to drop my cube into the symmetry object. Everything in Cinema works by dropping something into something else. So if you have like an effector or a deformer, either the deformer will live inside of an object or if this wants to be symmetried or Booleaned, it can live inside the Boolean. So I have a symmetry. It's going the wrong direction. It's on the wrong plane, wrong axes. So I'm going to really quickly drop that. There we go, X, Y. That looks good. Looks kind of like a bug bus. Got big old bug eyes. I can tell those are in the wrong place. Great. So now we have this shape. Those look roughly where I want them to be, but I can always tweak these later. I'm going to use a Boolean to now cut them out. So same deal. Drop that in there. I don't really need to zero these out because I'm moving the layer above it. But I can take this object, drop my windows. It's a symmetry. Let's just really quickly name those. And then let's drop our bus into there. And nope, I missed it. There we go. And now we've cut out the windows. But because I don't need this background geometry there, I am going to go into my Boolean object and change it from A subtract B, so A subtracting B, the bus minus the windows, to A without B. So now I have this cut out of this bus. It's a really quick way of just kind of roughing out the shape of your object. I believe that that is a much narrower piece there. Let's see, how are we lining up? That's looking pretty good. I think maybe that window goes a little far back, so I can just take my cube, move it forward, and this all happens nice and live. And the very last thing I want to do, actually, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to just slightly tilt that backwards. Great. What good is a window without a window? So to create the geometry for the glass, all I'm going to do is I'm going to take that Boolean object, and I am going to use the control key to drag it. Nope. There we go. I'm sorry, the command key on a Mac. And so now I have, nope, I did that wrong. There we go. All right, so in my Boolean, instead of A without B, I'm going to do A intersect B. And now I have window geometry using the exact same geometry, just inverted. And so that allows me to kind of build out that geometry really fast. Just for the sake of what we're doing right now, oh, let's create a really quick texture. Just to kind of differentiate the windows. I created it down here, create new material. It appears in my list of materials. I just dragged it right here onto the window, onto my geometry, or I can drag it over here onto the actual object. And let's really quickly make this a little darker, just so we see what that looks like. Great. Next thing we're gonna do is we're just gonna make a couple wheels. I will say that it was very difficult to figure out how wheels work on trucks. I didn't know this. I just figured you'd look up on Google the dimensions of the tire and then the dimensions of the hubcap. But no, there's like a mathematical equation. I don't know if anyone drives trucks or large rigs, but that took me like a good 2 hours to like puzzle out that math. I'm not proud of that, but it's true. So I'm going to start with a tube object because that is the most wheelish looking thing that I can think of. I'm going to again drop that into my bus null. Oh, that came in way wrong, didn't it? It's huge. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, it's on the wrong axes. So I'm going to change that to Z. That looks pretty good. Just quickly adjust the dimensions of this. Make it a little more narrowish. Bring that out. OK, that's too narrowish. And we can switch our views and look at this from the side to kind of line it up how we think it's going to work. So I don't really know where this is going to be, but I know there's a door there from my boards. Let's just kind of line it up to the ground. That looks pretty good. Next, what we're going to do is we're just going to create a simple cylinder and drop that into our tube. Again, I'm going to zero that out. I'm going to change the orientation to the Z direction. Now this is way, 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 way too big. There we go. Let's zoom in on this to kind of get a little bit of a better idea. Radius a lot farther down. All right, that looks pretty good. So let's just kind of really roughen this out very simply. I will go in later on in a project like this, convert it to geometry, and tweak around with the actual points. But for now, let's give it a little fillet on the inside. Let's really up that fillet. Oh, it's not quite wide enough. There we go. I'm going to just really quickly, for the sake of this, change the fillet on the tires. That is like a big donut. We don't want that. Let's lower the amount of segments. Let's make this about 0.5. Nah, let's make it about 1. All right, that's a basic wheel. That'll do for what we're trying to do right now. But I only have 1, and I need more. So what I'm going to do is I am going to, again, use our handy-dandy symmetry object, but because I already have 1 in the scene, I'm going to take this one down here, and I'm just going to make a new one, delete everything out of it, drop my tube in there, and then automatically I have wheels on both sides. But that's only 1 wheel. That doesn't look very stable. It's not a Segway bus. So I am going to group this. One of these days, I'll hit the right button. There we go. So when you use these objects, nulls are a great way to put multiple objects into your scene, into the same symmetry or Boolean or whatever. So I'm going to just really quickly make another wheel. Just kind of throw that back there. There's probably, I don't remember if there's 2 in the back, but that's good. That'll do. That is just basic modeling to get the rough shape for what I want. Because this is a stage where I would probably want to get the dimensions and the speed and the editorial right before I spend too much time modeling the bus. So next I'm going to move on to, first of all, because I have this in here, we can see how this works. Let's select our camera. Great. That looks great. That's that bus we just modeled. Awesome. And furthermore, before we move on, I have this poster on the side is going to be a super important part of it. So I'm just going to put something in there that will help be a stand-in for now. So I've already created this. It is a cube and then a flat piece of just plain that has a texture on there that I can see. So I have a couple different textures on there to see if, you know, how the reading looks in here before I move on to After Effects. But for the sake of this, I'm just going to use the checkerboard. All right, that looks good. So the next section is we are going to play around with the badge. So let's go back to our boards and take a look. So what we have is a standard lanyard, you know, not too dissimilar from the ones we're all wearing. And I did something. Okay, there. The modeling is going to be pretty simple, so I'm going to skip that. Basically, we have this nylon strap. We have a little bit of a metal buckle that has a couple different points of movement. And we have Red Giant trying to update. And we have this lanyard. So let's see. It comes in from behind the bus. It swings in, and it comes into frame. OK, that's cool. So this is the final version project. So you can kind of see how I built this, how it looks, how we're trying to get there. And what I'm going to do is, if you'll notice, it kind of feels dynamics-y. It feels like it has some real-world properties to it. But everything in here is just keyframes, right? And when we go into our non-animated one, I'm going to go in and just kind of get a little idea of what the geometry was that I built. I looked up some lanyards online. I grabbed a couple from my closet from past SIG graphs and stuff. And just sort of rough this out. Now, the basic idea of how I animated this is really very simple. And I'm going to open a new project to kind of give you an idea of just the basic tools I used. So just using a simple cube, let's make this small, narrow, and tall. There we go. Let's give it some segments. You can't see them. There we go. Let's up those segments. There we go. So it has a lot to bend and deform. So what I did was I used scale and rotation and bend and twist. So if I take this cube and I make it editable, then I take my anchor point and just drag it all the way to the top. This is basically the idea of the swing. Then with this selected, I'm going to select a bend deformer. If you bring in a bend deformer straight out, if you just click it, it will be a large 200 by 200 cube, but if you hold shift when you have your object selected, it will conform the deformer to your shape. So with the bend deformer, you can see that it can bend your geometry nicely. Now, one thing it does in this mode is you'll want to, for realistic objects, non-cartoony objects, to keep y-axis length, because that will, this nylon, it bends, but it doesn't stretch. If it was stretchy, that would make sense to keep that on. And then I used also a twist deformer. So holding shift, I'm going to select that, and it puts it right in the space there. So let's see. If I have this twist selection selected, I can turn it, and it twists my object. So that's cool. Lanyards do that. That makes sense. One thing is layer order. It's really important with deformers that you stick to the correct layer order, because twist before bend makes sense. But if I do it the opposite way, when I do the twist, it's going to twist it all around. And this is not really what we're going for. I'm not saying you never want to do this. You might want a plant that's real curious about something behind it. But in the meantime, we're going to switch that back around. So those are the basic deformers and the rotation that we're going to use. So stepping back into our badge project, I'm going to really quickly rough out like kind of a camera position that I want to start with. That's cool. Great. Now I'm going to select my badge. So I already have this set up so that the center point, the anchor point, is on top. And really quickly, let's see if this is about roughly where I want to be starting with my coordinates. At the first frame, that's not where I want to start. I'm going to go forward a little bit. Let's just say 30 frames. I'm going to have it swing just a hair forward. That looks good. Cool. Now I'm going to go back, and this is where I really want it to kind of disappear from frame. So just for now, a negative 45 seems good. Then I'm going to use my bend deformer to go the rest of the way to wipe it out of frame. You can change the angle of your bend right here. So it's on the wrong angle. So I'm going to change this to 90. That seems good. And I'm going to bend it out of frame. Great. Now we're going to move a little bit farther forward, back to where our keyframe was. There we go. Negative 13. That looks good. And so when we back off a little bit, you can see that it swings and it moves. So something about doing this kind of animation, especially this sort of like chain animation, is you have to think about the weight of your objects. So when I'm doing this nylon strap, nylon is really light. The whole rig is pretty light, but in this particular instance, the nylon is light. It probably won't bend a ton. It probably will swing just as much. So it's important that I have both of those aspects in there. But just for this, swinging forward is not enough. I want it to go backwards a little bit as well. So I'm going to go a little bit the same amount. And with my badge selected, coordinates, I'm going to have it backing off negative 3. It was going plus 5, and then I'm negative 3, because I do want it to settle a little bit. And then I'm going to use my bend. And right around that same place, I am going to change this to... That didn't do that, right? There we go. Oh, actually, I'm sorry. Yeah. It's swinging backwards a little bit. So let's make that, 3. And so right now, you can see how this is moving. It's not particularly natural if you look at it from far away. But that's part of why I didn't want to use dynamics. If I had like a realistic setup where I could see the whole scene and I want this thing to swing realistically, I might use a dynamic setup, but because I really want this to come into frame, into camera, and then slow down really fast, but still have a little wobble, it's not really a realistic move, but I want it to look realistic. So just from where I am, I've got it swinging in, and then I'm backing off a little bit. So let's find our framing a little bit more. Nope, we're too close. Swings in and back. That's cool. That'll do. And we can even make this swing a little bit back forward again. At this point, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my badge, and I am going to zero out the swing, because I figure it'll come to rest pretty fast. Oh, I got a little trigger happy and hit too many buttons there. Let's bring that to 0. Keyframe. Bend. Negative 3. Yeah, that's pretty good. Great. Let's move to another section, because we talked about the twist. So this is about where it's going to end, and I want it to sort of, let's see. Let's just twist it a little bit. Good. Let's go back in time and go the opposite direction. I don't have to go all the way off of frame for this. I can just sort of, there we go. Let's spin it around like that. So now when it spins in, there we go. But here's the thing is, I consider the spin, the twist, to be a, it's really a separate animation from the swing. Like, so gravity is dictating this movement. But that twist, that's probably more air density. Like, it's going to be doing it on a different timing. So, and different timings will add a little more interest to the scene anyways. So if I take this and offset it a little bit, as it starts to swing back, it's still twisting back a little bit. And then back there, I'm going to go a little bit farther forward. But farther forward, way farther forward than my swing backwards and forwards. And I'm just going to like kind of tilt it just a little bit. Because again, this is unrealistic, not realistic. There we go. Yeah. Now, that's just one level of animation. The next level is I really want to make all of these pieces move separately. Because that's really going to sell it, especially with the weight of the thing. So the strap, we already talked about the sort of dynamic nature, the lightness and the of that strap. But then the metal is a little different. Metal tends to be a little heavier. It doesn't react to the air quite so much. So that might be a little bit freer in how it moves. So one thing to notice is when you select things, let's just say the clip strap. All right, there you go, strap loop. If I have the deformers turned on, you won't see, notice how this point doesn't change position. When you have these deformers on here, you see it's not centered to it. It really is centered, but the deformer is moving it in a different place. Okay, so let's see, let's find that starting frame. All right, this is where the swing finishes its first pendulum-y move. I'm gonna go a little bit beyond that to find my first ending position of my strap loop. But before I do, I want to open up another project really quick to demonstrate what I'm about to do. So, finish look, swing example. Something about how these objects swing to add more interest when you're not doing an actual dynamic simulation is these are all the exact same geometry, but in this instance on the left, you will see each one of these pieces with the same keyframes. Each one is swinging the same amount at the exact same time. And then I delay by 6 frames every joint. So this one would be at frame 0, this one would be at frame 6, and this would be at 12. And then this one is twice as many. So when I play this, you can see that this is if everything had the same keyframing. I mean, it looks fine for, you know, it's animation, but you really see a little more personality, a little more realism, and the more you do it, you can kind of get a different idea of the weight of a thing. This might have a little more momentum than the one on the left. And it adds more interest, and that's kind of more what we're going for. So that's why we have all these pieces that we're going to animate separately. So back into our project. So this strap, I think the loop strap is going to rotate like that. All right, so I'm just gonna move it a few forward like that, great. I'll go back to the beginning, except I'm going to, like I said, offset it, there we go. And then back here, with that selected, I am going to go negative 20 seems good. There we go. I even want to make that a little bit more pronounced, how it has like a follow through, because I'm thinking this thing is very lightweight. It's going to follow the motion so that when the lanyard stops swinging and starts to swing back, that's when it really starts to kick up, where the badge really starts to kick up, especially at this joint. So that's good. But then as it goes backwards, same deal. I'm going to find that last point, and I'm going to go a little bit farther forward. Strap loop. Negative 6. And then a little bit farther forward there, and 3. So this is mostly a very rigid piece of it. All right, but that's good. So another thing is this next piece that I want to do is this little jingly jangly bit of metal that's kind of in a little circular joint. And that thing, I could animate that myself. It would probably rotate on a few different axes. But for the sake of what I want, I just want a little bit more realism, but I'm going to fake it. So I'm going to put a vibrate tag onto that hook. And what that is up in tags, you have a whole bunch of Cinema 4D tags that come with the program. And vibrate is one of them. And it's really just kind of a random generator for your position, scale, and rotation. So I'm going to turn on enable rotation on my rotation. That was redundant. If I play this starting past our animation, you can kind of see what it does. It just kind of got a little jingle jangle, adds a little bit of life to what that thing would be. That's great. So if I play back my animation that I've already created, it's just a little extra, right? And so the very last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to animate the badge itself. When I look at these objects, I think about how they're going to move. The strap is going to bend, it's going to twist. This is only going to rotate. This piece is going to jingle jangle. And down here, this can rotate forward and backwards, side to side, and it can probably also move a little bit, but I'm not going to worry about that right now. So what I'm going to do is, grabbing that badge, I am going to do the exact same thing that I did before, find my initial position, go a little bit even farther than where this animation was happening, like that, and just kind of move it a little forward to negative 16. That looks good. But I'm also going to kind of, that rotation looks pretty good, side to side. Go back to my beginning. Let's set this to 20 just to be fun. And I don't know, 6. I'm really just guessing here. There we go. That looks pretty good. That's some fairly natural animation. Same deal where when it swings backwards, I want it to overshoot. So I already had negative 16, so 15, it goes backwards. Change this to 10. And then let's have it settle a little farther down. And also our loop, strap loop, let's change that to 0. And one last little bit is to take that rotation, that twist that I forgot about, y'all didn't forget about it, and twist it back towards the camera a little bit. In fact, let's make it 10. Okay, so now we have some not really terrible faked dynamics. And I mean, this is 15 minutes, like, you know, normally you'd sit down and tweak it more. That intro is taking kind of a long time. Probably more than we want. So if we want, we can open up our timeline. I'm just going to grab all those keyframes from the beginning. Let's see. This is the swing in. Yeah. You can see that gap is way bigger than all the other ones. So I'm just going to drag them all. Let's see how that looks. That's pretty cool. Yeah, pretty good. It's still a little slow motion, but that's fine for where we are right now. Okay. So the very last section we are going to do is... We have our bus animation, we have our badge, and we don't really know what they're going to look like together. And one of our constraints was the timing, how long this was going to be. And originally, I want to say that it was around 8 or 9 seconds is what they were projecting they wanted this to be. And through the process, we realized that that was not nearly enough time for readability, especially with things moving side to side on that bus. And also when this thing flips around, twists around. To reveal the other side. So let's bring it into After Effects to do a little quick editorial. So first of all, I am going to save this temporarily as, let's see, NAB badge temp. And let's go to our bus. Great. And I am going to save as temp. Okay. So we have saved these projects. We're going to open up After Effects, new project. We're going to start fresh. So going back to my Finder, I'm going to find my new project files that I created, temp and temp. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to drag them right into After Effects. You can import them with Command-I or, you know, open them with a double click in the project window. The cool thing about After Effects and Cinema right now is they work so well together. It's kind of a big file. It's going to take a second. All right, there we go. So I'm going to grab these two, drag them into a new project, a new comp, I should say. Single composition, sequence layers. And there we go. Okay, so tour bus start here. You'll see it comes in just like footage, just like I rendered out a play blast. And we have control over how this is rendered in Cinema 4D up here where it says software. So that's just the software rendering of play blast. You can do OpenGL if you have a really nice video card. You can do a different drafts. So I don't know, final. I don't know what I have in this project right now. Let's try draft. All right, there we go. It's a little smoother. But for now, let's just do software. Sometimes it takes a second to update. There we go. Okay. So the important part, based on these boards, is this meeting place where I have the bus leaving and the lanyard coming in. So I want that to be feel like a very natural overlap. And also, I don't have a lot of time, so I really want that to be as overlappy as possible because that's not part of the title sequence where we're seeing any important information. So I'm going to find a little place where this bus is about to leave frame. I'm going to take my lanyard and just overlap it underneath. It doesn't just come in as footage. It comes in with an alpha, which is really nice. And that looks pretty good. So I'm going to just do beginning and end. Do a little quick RAM preview. You can see it start to come in. There we go. Oh, I got real lucky with that timing. That's pretty good. Close enough. I might move this a little over to the side. A little bit more to the right. There we go. That timing feels real good. And I didn't render a single frame out of Cinema 4D, which is really cool. It really saves me a lot of time. I can tweak this pretty fast and then just do really fast renders and shoot them over to my client. But however, something about this where maybe I find that my bus is moving too quickly or my camera's moving too quickly and I can't read the information that well. So I have this moving. Oh, that's actually a pretty good speed. But yeah, no, that's all right. You know what I'm going to do is I am going to shorten that clip a little bit. And I could do that by making this, you know, like 90% speed or 110% speed or whichever way you look at the math. But instead, what I'm going to do is I want to change this in Cinema because I don't want to render extra frames or, you know, worry about frame blending by changing the speed or anything. So what I'm going to do is go right back into this project. And one way you can do it is if you reveal source and project. That's my tour bus. It's right there. You can go up to Edit Original, and it will open it back up in whatever version of Cinema you have. So I'm going to just jump right back into my project because it's already open. And I am going to use the timeline to find that place where this is. Okay, good. So that's the big space in my animation where you see the side of the bus. Okay, that's cool. I'm going to just grab all of these keyframes and just move them in a little bit. So it's shortened it up probably, I don't know, I didn't count, but I don't know, 10, 15 frames, something like that. That's great. So all we're going to do is we're just going to save it. Go back into our After Effects project. It knows it's been saved. It checks. It spins a little bit. It's having a beach party. There we go. And so now we have our updated 3D file in here. What we will notice is that because I've changed it, the timing is going to be a little different from where we were before. So I'm going to have to adjust my edit. See, that's starting to go away, and the bus is starting to wipe off, and we want that badge to start coming in. So let's see how that is. Let's move it a little bit farther over. Well, that looks pretty good. All right, I like that timing better. And the very last step we're going to do here is for the side of this bus, because this has to be done in After Effects and finished in After Effects, we need to be able to put an object onto that, a pre-comp. So one way you could do this is you could render this out of Cinema and render it with an AEC file, and that will bring in all of your nulls from your scene. And since I've already put this poster object in here, and I added an external compositing tag, which is, again, in your Cinema 4D tags, And you can see it's named Bus Side Poster. With the Cineware plugin, I can hit Extract. And it will bring in all of my scene lights, which I don't need in this case. I need my camera. And I've got my bus side poster, which is a null. So that if I were to create, well, this won't be the right size or anything, but let's make just a solid, make it 3D, and shift parent it to my poster. The scale is way wrong. So let's just scale this kind of within the right scale. That's good enough for now. You can see that without going back and rendering, without exporting an AEC file, I get all my important information so that I can deliver this to the client and they can replace the poster and change out all the characters whenever they want. And that was a huge help, and it was really easy to switch out the poster information and the information on the badge every time that there was a note on a change of style, so that like in Photoshop, I would lay out the initial characters, bring it in as a comp into After Effects, and then just work in After Effects after that. And so that is it. That is basically my process for Tales for the Tour Bus. Yeah, I think I covered everything. Anyways, thank you very much. I think we're going to do a couple questions. In the meantime, if you want to check me out online, I have a website, pennyz.com. My Twitter is baffledbyfoxes. My Instagram is fifinominon. And I work at Rooster Teeth in the compositing department on Ruby and an upcoming show, Genlock, which is going to be really cool. If you like giant robot anime, it's going to be really fun. And awesome. Thank you.